page and you would like to come across and watch us on YouTube so that you can actually interact with us and type in your questions and give your comments, all you need to do is look at the bottom of this video screen and there's a watermark that says YouTube. Click on that and it will take you straight over to YouTube. If there's anyone that you know that should be here and wants to be listening in and they're not quite sure how, give them the link now so they can come over and join us, because we've got a really great show for you today. And for those of you that have never met me, by the way, I'm Carol Dodsley, better known as the How To Girl, and I have a fantastic guest who has joined me today, Bob Burg, who is the author of The Go-Giver. And we're going to let Bob introduce himself and tell you more about that. The Go-Giver, by the way, is a book, which is fantastic book. So let's go over and say hello to Bob. Hi, Bob.
Hello, Carol. Greetings from across the pond, my friend.
It is so fantastic to have you here. Isn't it wonderful how we can connect with people the other side of the world so easily and so clearly?
Well, you know what they say, modern technology, when it works, it's fantastic.
Exactly. And at the moment, we're working, which is cool. So, Bob, I only gave a really short introduction there. I didn't tell anybody anything about you, why you wrote the book, where it came from, what it's for, or anything. So how about you tell everybody a little bit about yourself?
Well, the book, The Go-Giver, it's a parable, a business fable. It's a story of a young, up-and-coming, aggressive businessman by the name of Joe, who's a good guy and trying very hard, but very frustrated because regardless of how hard he tries, he doesn't seem to be getting anywhere fast. And then he meets a man who becomes a mentor to him by the name of Pindar, who introduces him to some others. And Joe learns some very basic principles that allows him to really kind of shift his entire focus and shift his entire way of conducting business as well as conducting his life. And he becomes very successful. And these are based on laws and principles that have worked, I would suspect, since time immemorial. And the people who are successful have already been doing these, so I don't think there's anything new. I was very fortunate to write this with a brilliant storyteller by the name of John David Mann. And, you know, it's been very, fortunately, been very well received by people and been a lot of fun.
And what was it that made you want to write the book? Because you've written other books in the past, bestsellers, and what made you want to go to this?
My other books, Carol, have been very much how-to books. Endless Referrals was probably my biggest book before this, which was really just a book showing people how to cultivate and create relationships based on developing what I call know, like, and trust relationships, leading to really filling your funnel and calendar with A-list, high-quality prospects and great referrals. And I'd always been a big fan of parables, starting with Og Mandino's Greatest Salesman in the World, Spencer Johnson and Ken Blanchard's One-Minute Manager, Johnson's One-Minute Salesperson, Robin Sharma's The Monk Who Sold His Ferrari, Chris Widener's books, and a whole bunch of others. Who Moved My Cheese, also by Spencer Johnson. And I always thought great ways of teaching lessons and sharing information that's easy to take in. So I had the idea for The Go-Giver, and actually it germinated in my mind for a couple of years. And I came up with a basic sketch of some of the characters, but it took me about a minute of trying to write it before realizing that there's a huge difference between writing a how-to book, which is fairly easy because you're basically just writing down things you already know, and writing a story, a fictional story. And I can tell a story from stage when it's a real story. You're just relating it, and that's fine. There's a big difference between that and making up a story. So I asked John David Mann, who was a friend of mine. I'd never met him, but he was a friend of mine anyway, a very good friend, because he was the editor-in-chief of a magazine I used to write for. And he's so brilliant and always made my writing so much better than it was. And I knew that he'd be the guy who could take this. I asked him to be the lead writer and storyteller. And he was a pleasure to work with. And once we got our publisher, it took 25 tries because we got turned down by 24. But we ended up being with a tremendous, terrific publishing house, Penguin. Their business, one of their business divisions, Portfolio, and they've been so great and so supportive. But once we got the nod from them, it took us about probably only 3 months to finish the rest of it. And it's been a very nice outcome.
Sounds great. And like you say, you know, you went from something completely different, from writing how-to books that are very ordered and it's what you know and you just sort of tell people how to do it, into doing a fictional book. Why did you want to do that story and that parable? What was it that sort of drove you into wanting to share a story like that?
Well, stories connect with people. I think we learn better through stories. It's a lot more fun. And I think people are really looking for those shorter, kind of easy to digest type of books nowadays. My friend Mark Sanborn, who wrote The Fred Factor and so many other great books, and his books are pretty much how-to books. They're all very short, very succinct, filled with wisdom. And I think those are the kind of books, you know, not the big books like Atlas Shrugged is one of my favorite books of all time. So there's those too. But I think by and large, when you can present information that's sort of in bite-sized chunks and bits and make it fun to read, I think you're going to provide much more value to people. So that was really the reason for doing it.
Yeah, and I quite agree with you about the bite-sized chunks, especially nowadays that we've got so much information that we can get hold of. You know, you can get so overwhelmed. For me as well, when I pick up a book now, I do like to have a book that is an easy read. I don't mind if it's a longer book, but it's got to be easy. It's got to keep me engaged. It's got to really get me sort of my imagination going as well for me to actually focus on it.
Yeah, I agree with you. I agree with you.
So it's called The Go-Giver. And it's about this guy Joe that you've said, and just tell people what being a go-giver really is all about. And obviously we're talking in a business context here, although this works in your personal life as well. But what is it about being a go-giver and these principles that you were saying, you know, the most successful people are using them all the time? There's nothing new here, but what is it that people need to think about?
Well, the basic premise of the book, of the story, is simply that shifting one's focus from getting to giving. Now, when we say giving in this context, what we mean is constantly and consistently providing value to others. And that doing this is not only a nice way to live life, it's a very financially profitable way as well. And that's the key. When we say, you know, what is a go-giver? It's somebody who has either learned to shift that focus, or maybe intuitively knew, and that's just the way they've always done it. But for most people, I think they have to learn that, because the paradigm, the model of the world, is that you have to focus on the taking, because it's a dog-eat-dog world. In fact, you know, in the story, Joe, you know, sort of says to, asks Pindar right from the beginning, isn't this kind of naive? I mean, isn't it a bit unrealistic to believe that in today's day of self-absorption, corporate scandals, and dog-eat-dog competition, that one can actually give their way to success? And what he finds out is not only, you know, isn't it naive? No, it's not. Not only is it not naive, it's actually very practical. When you focus on others, when you move from what we call, Carol, an I focus to an other focus, people feel good about you. They relate to you. They connect with you. They probably are more interested in having relationship with you. In this case, business, but whatever. And, you know, and again, we call, and it typically goes win-win. Now, we call these types of people go-givers, and they tend to be the most successful people financially, as well as the other areas of life. And, you know, we talk about, you know, well, money isn't everything. And no, of course it's not. It's energy. It's an exchange of value. It's a result of value. And yet, as Zig Ziglar, the famous U.S. speaker, has often said, money may not be everything, but it ranks right up there with oxygen. And sometimes it really seems that way. But whether we're talking success in terms of financial, physical, spiritual, mental, emotional, social, you know, it is important. Now, this brings up a question that people will ask. Well, the name of the book is The Go-Giver. So are you and John David Mann saying that basically it's just that nice guys or nice gals or nice people finish first? And the answer is no. That's not what we're saying at all. Now, being nice, and when I say nice, I'm using that interchangeably with kind. Sometimes they're two different things, but in this case, let's say they're the same. Being nice, being kind, not only is that a good thing for its own sake, it's very helpful, again, in creating relationships. It's easier to succeed when you're nice, when you're kind. More people are going to be with you, rooting for you. But obviously, there's more to it than that. I mean, I think I can say that with confidence because you and I and everybody watching this, we all know plenty of people who we would describe as simply nice people, who we would also have to describe as simply broke people. So it's not enough just to be nice, as important as that is. Success is also a matter of doing the correct things in the success process that allows a person to be successful and finish first. And the five laws that John and I provide in the book, they're simply meant to share those principles that if someone will utilize them, all five of them, not one of them, two of them, three of them, or even four of them, but all five of them in conjunction, they absolutely must be successful.
Yeah, and I love the way you said that, which a lot of people, because they're nice and they're giving, I love that you brought up the fact that there are nice giving people who are broke, but they don't have to be. And I think what I'm seeing a lot of is the balance is being tipped. People are being told, you've got to be nice, you've got to give, you've got to add value. Always put what value you can offer before you think about what will you get in return. But it's not about giving for free all the time, is it?
No, and in fact, there's nothing about being a go-giver that means that you give for free. And now, don't get me wrong, providing value to people is a strategy, and it works. It's a very good strategy. I mean, let's face it, when you provide value to people in terms of knowledge or wisdom that they can use, connections, different things, that person comes to feel good about you, and they get to see a little bit of what you... it's like, you know, when we go to a local shopping, grocery store, and they come by with free cookies. Well, they give you a cookie not because they're just being nice. They give you a cookie as a strategy. When you take a bite of that sample cookie, you think, that's delicious. I want more. That's fine. That's a strategy. John and I, when people come to the website, we give them a free chapter of the book. Why? Because we're nice guys? No. I mean, I hope we are. We do it. We give it to them because we want them to enjoy the chapter, feeling that if they do, they're going to want more. So that's a strategy. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with it, but that's not being a go-giver, and it's not being a go-giver. It's just a business strategy. Now, when we say being a go-giver, when we're talking about giving, there is a value for value exchange. The key is the first law. The foundational principle is the first law, the law of value. And if we go through this, I think I can probably explain it in a way that will make a lot of sense regarding how that works.
Yeah, I've just pulled up because I've actually got the five laws here in front of me. And I was going to ask you if we could talk about those five laws just to give people real clarity about this, because it is so important. And I get really... I get quite sad and sometimes frustrated that people are misunderstanding this being a go-giver and adding value, and they're actually hurting themselves in the process, and then they're getting all tangled up, and it's like, but I'm doing that and it's not working, and I'm just getting miserable, and I'm just getting more and more broke. And it's like, they just have to get clarity on what it is about, you know, the five laws that we'll have a look at. And you just mentioned the first one, the law of value. That is something to be so clear on, isn't it?
Yeah, well, first, you know, like you, I also get frustrated. Actually, I don't. I just love the way you said frustrated. You said frustrated. It's so British, so wonderful. I just wanted to say frustrated. That was great. The law of value. The law of value simply says that your true worth is determined by how much more you give in value than you take in payment. But let me explain that, because even that sounds sort of counterintuitive, almost counterproductive. I mean, how do you give more in value than you take in payment and not go out of business? You know, how do you thrive? You know, how do you survive? Never mind thrive. Give more in value than you take in payment. So let's explain what that really means. To understand this, we need to understand first the difference between price and value. Price is a dollar figure. It's a dollar amount. It's finite. It is what it is. Value, on the other hand, can be defined as the relative worth or desirability of a thing to the end user or beholder. In other words, what is it about this thing, this product, this service, concept, opportunity, idea, what have you, that brings with it so much worth that someone will willingly and happily exchange their money for that and be very happy that they did while you make a very healthy profit. And let me give you an example, a couple of quick examples of what that might be. Let's say you were to hire an accountant to do your taxes. Okay. Do you call them accountants over there too?
We do.
Yeah. Okay. I just like to make sure, you know, that I'm using the same terminology. So you hire an accountant to do your taxes. This accountant charges you. Now, do you mind if I say dollars rather than pounds? Because it's easier for me to.
Absolutely fine.
Okay, this accountant charges you, let's just say, $1,000 to do your taxes. That's his fee or his price, okay? But what does he give you in terms of value in return for this $1,000? First, he saves you $5,000. He saves you 30 hours of time, and he provides you with the security and peace of mind of knowing it was done correctly. So we see right here that value can be concrete in terms of the money that you were saved. It can also be conceptual in terms of the feelings of peace of mind, which may even be more valuable to someone than the money that they're saving. So what he did is he gave you well over $5,000 in value for a $1,000 price. So what did he do? He gave you more in value than he took in payment. You feel terrific about it. He made a very healthy profit, which he should. And, you know, Carol, that's the kind of relationship we want to have with anyone with whom we do business. We want to provide them such an extraordinary value-based experience that they feel as though they received a lot more in use value than what they traded in cash value. That's actually the essence of a free market exchange, where both parties come away from the transaction much better off than they were before. Now, here's where focus comes in, because remember I talked about a go-giver, their focus. The focus is not on the money. The focus is on providing value to that person. Money is simply an echo of value. It's the thunder to value's lightning, which means the value comes first. The money is simply a direct and natural result of the value that you've provided. So that doesn't mean the money is not important. It doesn't mean making a profit isn't important. Money is important. Making a profit's important. It's just not where your focus is. The focus is on providing value. The money is what follows. Does that make sense?
To me, absolute sense. And I love the way that you put it so clearly and give some real good examples, because I know that that is one of the big issues or challenges that a lot of small business owners and solopreneurs are really struggling with, especially service-based people at the moment. You know, they want to give the value, but they've been told by so many people you've got to give it free, or they've got the perception that they've just got to keep going out there and giving free. You know, and we know that it's like here, we're doing an interview, you know, nobody's paying for the interview. They're not paying to listen in and learn so many great things from you. That's adding value, but it's not what you would do every single day of the week. You know, I wouldn't sit here every day interviewing people live on air and not charging. You wouldn't spend your time every single day sitting chatting to me and not charging. You know, because if we do that, I actually call it selfish. If you give everything for free, you're actually being selfish both to yourself, because you're going to run out of money. You're going to end up having to go and get a job or do something else to get some more money to be able to live. And you're also, to me, being selfish by not exchanging that value with that focus, as you said, on, first of all, the value you're giving. But you're being selfish because if you go broke, you can't keep giving any value.
That's right. That's very true. So there's two aspects here that I think we're talking about. One is understanding how it works, that business is a value for value exchange. It's just two different types of value. One is the value. One is the financial value, and one is the use value. And it's that value for value exchange. And again, the key is that both parties come away better off than they were before. So it's understanding that. And then it's making sure we don't fall into that treacherous dichotomy of thinking it's one or the other. You either, you know, are giving or receiving. No, it's both. You're giving and receiving. And some things you do, you start the cycle by giving first, but you allow yourself, you stay open to receiving. That's one of the laws we'll be talking about. So it's not, again, being a go-giver should never, ever be confused with not making a profit or just giving yourself away. It has nothing to do with that.
Yeah. And like I say, you've just explained that so well. And I know that people listening in, there'll be some people that will be going, oh my goodness, that's what they mean about value and my focus. That was really great. So if we look at the next law, the law of compensation.
Yeah, the law of compensation says your income is determined by how many people you serve and how well you serve them. So where law number one says to give more in value than you take in payment, law number two tells us that the more people whose lives you touch with that exceptional value, the more money you'll receive, the more money with which you'll be rewarded. Our accountant, again, did a great job in that first example, giving more in value than he took in payment while making a profit. So if you're his client, you probably feel great about him. You would do business with him again, and you'd most likely refer him to others. And his other clients probably feel the same way. So our accountant is very quickly amassing what we call an army of personal walking ambassadors. And as he continues to add that kind of exceptional value to the lives of more and more people, his income will continue to grow and grow. The key is understanding that while value is, law number one, value is very important, providing that exceptional value, buying experience. That Nicole Martin, one of the heroes in the book, Nicole explained to Joe, the protege, that law number one represents only your potential income. Because if you're providing that great value to only one person, you're still not going to make a whole lot of money. Law number two represents your actual income. Because aside from just providing that great value, it's the impact you're making in the lives of many, many, many people. So we could say that exceptional value, law one, plus significant reach, law two, is what equals very high compensation.
Yeah, and I think that reach is something that people struggle with as well. I work with a lot of people or talk with a lot of people who are still exchanging their time for money, which actually, in some ways, unless they are charging a very high price and have in working a lot of hours, they're actually still holding themselves back because, and in both of these laws, because they're holding themselves back because they're giving less value, or not less value, what they're giving to those few people is good value, but they're giving it to less people, which moves you into that second law, that they can't serve more and more and more people if they're actually blocking or giving themselves a glass ceiling that they can't break through.
Right. And this is one reason why referrals are so important. It makes your business a lot more fun, a lot less stressful, and a lot more profitable because you've got other people who are actually helping sell you to others. And I think referred prospects, it's easier to set the appointment with, obviously, because you're going in on borrowed influence. Price is less of an issue with a referred prospect. Now, that doesn't mean price is not important. It always plays some role, but it means that rather than selling on price, you can sell on value, and that's key. When you sell on price, you're a commodity. You know, when you're just trying to sell on low price, and they're only going to do business with you to the degree that your price is the lowest, and as soon as someone else comes along with a lower price, they're going to leave. So when you sell on price, you're a commodity. When you sell on value, you are a resource, and that's key. It's also easier to complete the transaction because you're going in on borrowed trust. And then it's also referred prospects are great because they're already of the mindset that that's how you do business. So they are used to you coming in, meeting people through referrals, selling on value rather than price, which they respect. They're used to you being able to complete the transaction, and then referring you to others is a natural part of the process for them.
Yeah, and if I can just pick up on this price bit that you just said about, because I know, you know, I don't know about in, I know America's not doing particularly brilliantly at the moment with their economy, and in the UK we're in a double dip recession, and there's a lot of people that are instantly, their first thing to say is, I have to lower my prices, I have to get cheaper than everybody else. That isn't actually true when you take the law of value into effect, is it?
Right. And what you need to do is look at ways to provide more value to people that isn't particularly costly. There are many ways, there are probably thousands of ways to add value to others. They come down to about five different categories, and that is excellence, consistency, attention, empathy, and appreciation. And when you're and none of those are particularly costly, but they do take focus, and it's always a focus on that other person. And so while everybody else is pulling, you know, I always say you cannot control the economy. The politicians are too busy ruining all of that. So you can't control the economy, but you can absolutely control your own economy, which doesn't mean it's necessarily going to be easier. But it does mean that when you work smarter, when you work with a value focus, when instead of pulling back on value as compared to price, as most of your competitors are, instead you're ramping up the value creatively and effectively, you still might have to work, you know, as hard or harder to make the same amount of money or maybe a little bit more, but you're going to survive, you're going to thrive. And then when the economy does turn back around, you're going to be in a very prime position.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, in a lot of the books that I've read, and I mean, Napoleon Hill is one of them, there are more millionaires made in the bad times than there are in the good times, because they're the people that keep pushing through, that never give up, and that keep adding value and keep taking that next step forward.
Yeah, well, you know, it's funny too. A good friend of mine, Randy Gage, has a new book out called "Risky Is the New Safe," and he's talking about all the differences, the changes. You know, things have changed, and a part of what he does in that book is he talks about how because things have changed so much, there's now more opportunity than ever, and he actually goes through how to actually do it. So, in fact, you can I'd suggest viewers check out riskyisthenewsafe.com, and you can see about the book. But it's a brilliant, brilliant look at how to thrive in difficult economic times.
I was just writing the name of that down as you were saying it, and I'm just sitting here thinking, oh, I would love to interview Randy.
Oh, he's a hoot. He really is. He really just well, he does. You'll see his video on the riskyisthenewsafe.com, and you'll see exactly how he presents himself. It's really a fascinating book, a great read.
Excellent. So let's move on, because I'm obviously we're not going to run out of time before we get to the fifth one, because I love the fifth one of these laws. The law of influence. Tell us
Yeah,
about that.
sure. The law of influence says that your influence is determined by how abundantly you place other people's interests first. Now, again, counterintuitive, counterproductive at best, perhaps, and downright Pollyanna-ish at worst. Place other people's interests first?
How could you possibly do that?
Now, first, let's make sure to qualify that statement. Let's make sure. Very frustrated. Now, let's make sure to qualify that statement too by letting people know when we say that, place other people's interests first, we certainly don't mean you should be anybody's doormat, that you should be a martyr, or that you should be self-sacrificial in any way, shape, or form. Not at all. It's simply as Joe in the story, the protege, learned from two of the other mentors, Ernesto and Sam, that the golden rule of business is that all things being equal, people will do business with and refer business to those people they know, like, and trust. And you know, there is no faster, there's no more powerful, there's no more effective way to elicit those know, like, and trust feelings toward you from others than by, again, shifting that focus from an I focus to an other focus. It's sort of, you know who says it's great? There's a great author in the United Kingdom, Thomas Power, who's the founder of eCademy. And in his book, Networking for Life, he says, and I love this, he says, the energy comes from a willing suspension of self-interest. Now, not the foregoing of self-interest. We're human beings. We are self-interested creatures, and that's great. That self-interest keeps us alive. It keeps us thriving. It keeps inventions going and the standard of living going up, you know, in a free market-based economy. But it's sort of like when you, in a movie, you know, there's the movie term, willing suspension of disbelief. When you know that the actors up there, obviously they're acting. I mean, you've seen them in other pictures. You're watching them on a big screen with a lot of other people. You know that, you know, Bruce Willis or Sean Connery or, you know, they're not really cracking jokes while some guy has a gun pointed at their head threatening to kill. No, but you willingly suspend yourself, your disbelief in order to enjoy the show, in order to feel the feelings and be able to, same thing here. You're willingly suspending your self-interest, and you are focusing on making that other person's life, you know, better, easier, richer, more fulfilling, or whatever it is that you do. And again, it all comes back to that focus. And the people who do that find that they attract other similar people into their lives. They're planting seeds of goodwill, seeds of great will, and they're developing those know, like, and trust relationships that make their life and their business a lot more fun, a lot less stressful, and again, certainly a lot more profitable.
Exactly. And it also, you know, when you turn everything around into these, you know, as we're going through these first three laws, you can see how they are so related to each other. And mm-hmm. I know that if I'm giving to people, if I'm adding more value, you know, if I'm thinking of them and what they need before I sit here thinking, right, I've got to make a quick, I'll say a quick buck, seeing as I'm talking to an American, I've got to make a quick buck. Who can I go and grab some money from? You know, if I think like that, it actually feels horrible. If I sit here and think, right, what are people looking for? So many people are talking about they'd love to know how to do this. I know how to do it. So I can actually help these people. And here you go. You know, you've been saying you want to learn this. I make money quite quickly. But I'm giving them exactly what they're looking for because I'm focused on how can I help them. And it actually makes me feel, it's not the money that makes me feel great. It's when they then come back and go, wow, that has been so helpful. Thank you so much. That means more to me because of the way that I'm focusing on other people, not on myself. I'm still looking after myself and I still like to buy nice pink jewelry, but the focus in business is on what am I giving?
Exactly. It all comes down to the focus. Hey, money is a wonderful thing. I never apologize for making money because that money is a reflection of the value that has been provided.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's go on to the next one, the law, and this one I love as well, because I'm always using this word, and there's a lot of people now that are starting to knock this word, the law of authenticity.
Mm-hmm. The law of authenticity says that the most valuable gift you have to offer is yourself. In the story, Deborah Davenport learned a very important lesson, and that is that all the skills in the world, the sales skills, technical skills, even the all-important people skills, as important as they are, Carol, and they are all very, very important, they're all for naught if you don't come at it from your true, authentic core. Now, when you do, when you show up as your true self, day in and day out, people respond very positively to that. People respond well, first of all, to consistency because we live in a very inconsistent world. So when you show up as yourself and they know who's showing up day after day, after week, after month, and so forth, they feel more inclined to be in relationship with you. On the other hand, I think people have gotten a lot more sophisticated, and I think that's a good thing. Because when the customers and when others are sophisticated, that always benefits more the people who have more value to offer, obviously. I think people can now sort of spot when someone is not really operating out of their true sense of integrity, as Gandhi described integrity as when everything you think and everything you feel and everything you say and everything you do are in alignment. And I think a lot of times, though, this gets a little bit confused because when someone's not operating totally authentically, it doesn't necessarily mean they're trying to be a phony. Now, there are some people who, that is true, they are. Some people are real good at it, and they can get away with it for a while. But not most people. Most people, I think, when they're less than authentic, it's more because they don't have the confidence in themselves to truly understand the value they bring to the market. Sometimes when someone is very naturally gifted with something, or just they intuitively know something, or they've put on that 10,000 hours of deliberate practice that Gladwell and Colvin talk about in their books, they tend to think that what they do is just very natural to everyone else as well. I'm sure you've counseled lots of people, and they've, you know, said something, and you've said, oh, that's brilliant, that's wonderful, and they've said, oh, no, everybody knows that. But no, they don't. And that's why it can be very difficult when you don't have a coach, or you don't have an advisor, or you don't have a mentor, to really understand the full value that you bring to the marketplace. And because of that, you will undersell yourself. You sometimes won't charge as much as you could or should, and you sometimes won't bring in that money because you don't feel confident that you have anything to really offer. And that's not true. We all have two types of value. We have intrinsic value just by virtue of being born, but we also have market value. We all have weaknesses, but we also all have strengths. And when we can tap into those strengths and bring them to the market, that's when we're really bringing forth our, as Mike Litton calls it, our asset of value.
And I think, you know, when you said there about people who don't realize how much that they are bringing, I actually struggled with that a lot. When I first started out, sure, I would sit there and think, and even now occasionally, because I find certain things so easy, and it's like, I'm thinking, well, I can't possibly go out and sell a program teaching people how to do this, because it's just so simple. And then I realized, and I was always actually challenging myself by trying to put more and more and more and more into my programs, into what I was doing for people, because I couldn't believe that that little bit was going to be high value and really, really help them. It was like, but you know, there's nothing special about that. And then I started to realize that actually there is a lot special about that. You know, there is always somebody who needs to learn what you know, and it doesn't matter. I see it a lot with solopreneurs who are in the early stages of their business, say the first year or two of their business, and they're so worried because they're comparing themselves with people that have been going for a long time, that have made lots of money, that are very successful, have loads of clients, and they're sitting there looking at them instead of looking around them at what they have now is perfect. They can offer it to the people that are looking for it, because there will always be somebody looking for that. So I then see them trying to sort of, and we're talking about this authenticity, they try and they start to follow people who tell them, if you're going to create a video, you have to do it like this, your lighting has to be like this, you have to have this sort of clothing on, and you have to use these words, and they start to get quite stumbly because they're not being natural.
This leads to another part of that, and you bring up a brilliant, brilliant point, and that is that we can, you know, we can learn, and we should learn from all others. The sages ask, who is wise, and answer that person who learns from others. And we can do that through books and CDs and seminars and coaching from people like you and all these great things. What we want to do, though, is we want to adapt people's wisdom. We want to make sure not to try to adopt their personalities and become those people. So we want to adapt but not adopt. Utilize, learn from them, implement their wisdom, but don't become them. Stay yourself. That's so, so very important.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that I make a really big thing about. I mean, today we don't have visitors because I've been out this morning. I've got two dogs, and they quite often come and join me on the TV show, because that is one of the things about working for myself, is I have the freedom to be at home, working from home, and have my dogs here. And quite often they'll be jumping up and join in, you know, and my lighting, for some reason today, we've gone quite dark in here. I do have a very snazzy screen to try and get the lighting better. But, you know, I'm not sitting in a TV studio with big cameras and things. And I am myself. You know, I'm sitting in this big black chair that people, I get criticism, people saying, you shouldn't be in that big black chair, you need to get rid of the chair. Well, I'm sorry, but it's comfortable. And I did try sitting on a stool for a couple of shows, and my back killed me. And it's like, no, this is me. You know, this, what you see is what you get. When I go out and meet people in real life, you know, in the real world, not the boxed world, they know me instantly because all of the pictures I'm using, you know, wrinkles and all, that is what you get. That's what you get offline. It's what you get online. And people that criticize that, you know, I make the best of what I have and what I do, but I don't change my personality. You know, I sit here and pull funny faces. My dogs come and I say hi and I share my stories and things because I actually want to attract people that feel comfortable with me. And what does make me really sad is you see people who are doing their marketing online, they do their videos, and they're actually following these people that have said, you have to do it like this. Now, I'm not saying the advice isn't good about lighting and things, but they are trying to be those people. And then when somebody meets them live, they don't recognize them. Now, hang on a minute, there's something wrong there, because if you've attracted someone through marketing and putting yourself out there in a way that isn't you, are those people actually going to really want to work with the real you?
There's a disconnect there, obviously, absolutely. So, and you know, remember, people always have comments. People will comment and criticize all the time. So, and it's okay to do that. It's okay, and it's fine to say thank you for, I appreciate that, and blah blah blah, and then do what you feel you do best. I mean, again, learn from everyone, and you can always consider people's advice. Always best to stay yourself. First of all, I think you look great in that black chair behind you. I don't think the lighting looks bad at all. And I'm a dog fanatic, so if the dogs were right there in your lap, I think that would be great. So, you know, so we're going to attract the kind of people who are naturally attracted to us. And by being ourselves, sometimes we're going to repel the people who wouldn't want to do business with us, and that's fine too.
Exactly. And I say that to people because sometimes I have people that say, but if I don't do that, then those people won't want to work with me. And it's like, well, do you really want to work with people who don't love who you are as a person, who don't feel that bond? You know, with me, I'm very straight talking. I say it as it is. If I'm doing coaching or mentoring, I can intuitively feel when people are making excuses and telling themselves stories. And I could sit there and go, oh, I know, it's really bad, isn't it, when that happens? It's really sad. And yeah, I get how hard it is. Well, usually I will say, look, come on, what are you telling yourself that story for? And they know they're telling themselves a story, and they know that I will just say it as it is, and I will shoot to the point. They are the people that keep coming back, and they want to learn more. The people that can't take that or don't like it, I don't want to attract them, because they're not right for me, and I would be walking on eggshells thinking, oh my goodness, if I say one thing, I'm going to upset them. You know, I want to repel those people, and I think it's good that people sort of get comfortable with repelling the people that are not right to work for them, with them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, as long as you do it with kindness and tact, you're fine. I mean, it, you know, repelling people doesn't, it just for people watching who don't maybe understand the difference, repelling people doesn't mean we say, you know, you go away. No, it just means that we're naturally going to attract the people who are more in alignment with our authentic selves, as opposed to the people who just aren't. And that's fine.
Exactly. So, and it really is about just be yourself and be comfortable in yourself. And if people are not confident in themselves, because there are a lot of people out there who are still struggling with that confidence, they don't believe in themselves, then work with someone that can help you pull that confidence out.
Exactly.
So that brings us on to one of my favorite ones, that I think this one, people get a very sort of, not everybody, but lots of people get quite confused with this one. And it's the law of receptivity. I've got it out.
Yeah, the law of receptivity simply says that the key to effective giving is to stay open to receiving. And late in the story, Pindar, the main mentor, asks his protege, Joe, to breathe out and hold that outgoing breath to the count of 30. Oh, Joe tries, but in seconds he begins to struggle, and in about 10 or 11 seconds he's now gasping for air. He's struggling to breathe. And Pindar says, "What's the matter, Joe? Can't do it?" And Joe says, "No, I can't just breathe out. I've got to breathe in as well." And Pindar jokingly said, "Well, Joe, what if I was to tell you it's been medically proven that it's actually healthier to breathe out than it is to breathe in?" And Joe just laughed. He said, "Well, that's silly. You can't do that. You've got to breathe out and breathe in, both." "Well, exactly. You breathe out and you breathe in. We breathe out carbon dioxide. We breathe in oxygen. We breathe out, which is giving. We breathe in, which is receiving. Giving and receiving are simply two sides of the very same coin, and they work in tandem. In fact, to try and focus on just one side of the equation while leaving the other out or minimizing the other is really an exercise in futility, because first, all giving is made possible only because it's also a receiving, and all receiving is made possible only because it's also a giving. And if you deny that, you're first denying someone else the right to give, and you're cutting off the flow. You're stopping the flow of abundance, which is cyclical. It's giving and receiving. The other thing is this. All the giving in the world, and again, as you know, when we speak of giving, we're talking about providing value. All the giving in the world is great, but it's all for naught if you refuse to make yourself available to receive in like measure. Because it's doing nobody any good. Now, the question becomes, and you know, I'll just tell you, in this chapter, we've had more people, John has, I have, we've had more people write to us saying that two things. One was that this law was the toughest to get their hands around, okay? But that some of them had to read it two or three times. Fortunately, they're all very short chapters. But that they said this book gave them permission for the first time in their lives to allow themselves to receive. It was the first time that they saw that receiving is a good thing. See, neither giving nor receiving is any better or more righteous than the other. It all comes down to focus. When you focused on the giving, providing value to others, immense value to others, consistent value to others, you have earned the right, not the entitlement, but the right to receive. It's just a matter of tapping into that. So focus on the giving and allow the receiving. And when you see someone who will not allow that, it is typically, in fact, I would say it's 100% of the time the result of an unhealthy relationship with money. And not only that, what makes that even more difficult is that this unhealthy relationship with money is unconscious. They don't even realize it. But remember, the messages that we receive from the universe from the time we're born, whether it's a combination of upbringing, environment, schooling, television news or all the news media, television shows, movies, we continually get hammered with these messages that money is bad, wealthy people are evil, or you know, all these ridiculous, crazy things. And so we believe it, again, unconsciously, and that's the challenge. So the first thing we've got to do about this is be aware that this could be an issue. And then second, we start focusing on changing ourselves in that way. We begin building on our small successes by receiving the little things. When someone compliments us, it's a matter of saying thank you. When someone offers to pay us, we say thank you. You know, it's those little things we can do. And constantly reading books about prosperity. Randy Gage, who wrote that great book, Risky is the New Safe. He has, if you go to my blog, which is at burg.com, and then go to my blog, you'll see a blog roll, a list of suggested blogs on the right-hand side. Randy Gage's prosperity blog is there. I read it every day. Why? Because I fall victim to the same messages that we all get, and I want to make sure that I'm guarding my mind. So I get my kind of daily dose of prosperity consciousness from reading that, you know? And so, again, these are the things we can do. First, we need to be aware of it, and only at that point are we in a position to then do something about it.
Yeah, and where, the minute you said about receiving compliments, I mean, that's actually in my book back to people, because, and I used to struggle with that as well, and you don't realize, like you say, it's unconscious, but so often somebody gives you a compliment, and instead of saying thank you, people immediately either push it off and go, oh, just this old thing, or they feel they have to give a compliment back, which is not what it's about. It's about just saying thank you. And you know, really enjoy that compliment. And that is, like you said, you mentioned it in the respect of finance and everything else as well. And there is all this rubbish in our heads. You know, we're brought up from young, you know, save your pennies and work hard. And, you know, rich people are mean people and horrible people. And it is getting rid of that. And I, when you said about you get your daily fix, you know, a lot of people sit and think, well, it's all right for them to say this stuff. They've got loads of money already. They're successful. But even people, when they are successful, you still keep your mind, because there's so much stuff in the world that can get in the way, isn't there?
Oh, absolutely. I'll tell you a funny story. Very soon after the book came out, and I have a home-based office, and I had a bookkeeper here who was doing kind of a monthly bookkeeping and accounting, and her name's Trina, and she was using this pen that she was writing with, and it was a really cool-looking pen. It wasn't particularly expensive-looking or fancy. I just liked the look of it, and I say, hey, Trina, that's a great pen. Where do you get that? She goes, oh, here, you can have it. You know, it's yours. And I went, immediately I went, oh, no, that's okay. And she goes, no, really, I'm giving it to you. I said, oh, that's all right, it's not my pen. It's fine. She goes, why won't you take it? I said, well, I wouldn't feel right about it. It's not my pen. So she turned around, she looked at me, and she said, Bob, it's really a very simple two-step process. Number one, she said, take the pen. Number two, say thank you. And I thought, and here I just wrote a book, co-authored a book, where law number five was the law of receptivity, and I wasn't accepting, I wasn't allowing myself to receive a little pen.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we all do that.
And it actually, what people don't always realize with that is, you know, if you hadn't taken that pen, and when she said, what's wrong with the pen, why won't you take it, you can actually hurt people by not being open to receiving.
Absolutely. You're denying them the gift of giving.
Exactly. Wow, we've gone through all five laws, and I can see just how they all, you know, they're all a bundle, really. Although we've gone through them individually, you can't have one without the other. It doesn't work.
No, you can, you know, any one of them is in and of itself fine, but without all five, I mean, it's not going to happen. I mean, you've got to, if you're not providing more value than you take in payment, the others don't matter. If you're not, you know, touching the lives of a lot of people with that value, not going to matter. If you're not putting other people's interests first and instead totally focused on yourself, people aren't going to relate to you. They're not going to want to do business with you. It's not going to matter. If you're not authentic, well, you're going to lose friends and right away, and if you don't receive, then everything else is all for naught. So no, that's why we say it's all five laws. And when people say, oh, I've tried it, it doesn't work, I can do a diagnostic with all of them, and we'll find out that they're not using all five. Or as they do it, they may feel they're adding value, but they're not adding value in a way that the other person feels it's of value. They may think they're putting the other person first, but they're not. Their own self-interest is coming through. Again, not that there's anything wrong with self-interest. We are self-interested creatures. But we need to be able to temporarily suspend that and be able to focus on the other person's interest. You know, so it, again, it's all those things. And so, you know, John and I have had so much great feedback. We've had people who, you know, leaders of organizations who've bought tens of books, hundreds of books, literally some have bought thousands of books because they wanted their team to live their lives and conduct business that way because it's more profitable for them. And that's why I like to say that the people who've done that, the early adopters of this book, were not the people who needed the book. It's the people who are already utilizing the principles of this book long before they ever read the book. they just wanted to be able to get those lessons out to others. And then from there, you know, fortunately it got to people who did need the book. And when John or I receive an email from someone who, you know, was able to take, you know, some thoughts in there and really turn their business around, what a wonderful compliment it is. And it's just a great feeling.
Yeah. Absolutely. I just want to read a couple of the, we do have a few comments. We've got no questions that have come in. There's one comment that I can't read because it's in a foreign language. I think it might be Spanish. I've no idea. So I'm sorry. I can't read that, whether it's a question or a comment. But there's people here saying, hi guys. Hello, Bob and Carol. Awesome content. Thanks for this. So people are really enjoying what we've been talking about here. And I'm aware that we've been going nearly an hour and we've done so much and spoken about so much. But what I'd like to ask you is, if you could give someone, and let's say, for example, someone that's in the early years of their business who are not yet seeing the success they want, or they're not yet finding enough clients that they want, what one piece of advice would you give to them?
Well, I think you need to find out how to do it by people who already have done it and have documented it. I mean, it's out there. Find the system. There's a system for doing whatever it is you want to do. I define a system as simply the process of predictably achieving a goal based on a logical and specific set of how-to principles. In other words, it's all about predictability. If it's been proven that by doing A, you'll get the desired results of B, then all you need to do is be willing to do A and do A consistently enough, and you'll get the desired results of B. So whether they take your coaching and tap into your systems directly, or whether they tap into whatever, it's first, don't try to do it alone. Don't try and reinvent the wheel. If the wheel's been invented, tap into that already invented wheel and do the same thing. Again, do it through your own sense of authenticity. Do it through your own way. But at the same time, you know, follow the recipe.
Yeah, I love that. Follow the recipe. That's a great title. That should be a book title. I might pinch that one.
I can go ahead.
Well, I want to say a really, really big thank you for coming on today and for chatting with me. You know, and the way we met was all through social media. I can't wait to get the book in my hands, because I was meant to have got it and it never arrived. But I have the laws. I'm going to put a link. Anybody that wants to find out more about the book, if you want to get the first chapter of the book, if you want to see the PDF that has the 5 laws on it and lots of other great stuff that Bob's put together, you can go over to his website, Bob Burg, B-U-R-G.com. But I'm also going to...
B-U-R-G.com.
Yeah, and I'm going to put the links under this video when it goes onto the How To Girl show page as a replay. All of the clickable links, so you can go straight through without even having to try and find them, will all be on the page there.
Excellent. Thank you.
So thank you, and hopefully we'll be able to have a chat again sometime.
I would absolutely love it. I would be delighted. Thank you so much for having me on your show today, Carol.
It's been a pleasure.